So just to introduce about myself, I am having an industry experience of around 13 years working in big data technologies, Hadoop, Amazon Web Services Cloud, Linux and Java. I'm currently based in India and given more than 60 sessions on Hadoop administration. So today the topic of our webinar is Hadoop, a highly available and secure enterprise data warehousing solution, where we are going to focus on the high availability and the security in Hadoop distributed file system. During the webinar, if you have any questions at any point of time, guys, you can drop your questions into this questions window, and I'll pick up the questions. I'll try to answer your questions as much as I can. After the webinar, suppose if you have any questions, you can get in touch with our sales team and they will certainly resolve your queries. You will get the recording and the PPT of this webinar after the 24 hours of this webinar itself. You're all muted right now on this call. Okay, so because there are like a lot of participants, so it's not possible for me to unmute every one of you. So you can drop your queries into this questions window itself. Okay, and if you have any questions at any point of time, just drop your questions into this questions window. I'll take it up. I'll try to reply all your queries. Okay, at the end of this webinar, we have a survey as well. Please do not forget to fill that survey. That will certainly help us to better our services, and we'll try to improve our services and provide you as best services as we can. So let us start the webinar now. So what will you learn today in this webinar? The topics we are going to cover is, what is big data all about? What is the hype of big data? Hadoop, a synonym of big data. Hadoop high availability. Hadoop as a data warehouse, hands-on on achieving the name node and yarn high availability, and hands-on on securing your Hadoop distributed file system via access control list. So this is what we are going to cover in our today's webinar, guys. So first of all, what is big data all about? Okay, so big data is huge data, a data that has got huge volume, coming so fast, and where we are having different varieties in the data. It's not possible for the traditional data warehousing systems or traditional applications to store the data or to process the data. Data which is so large, so complex, and so difficult to handle by the on-hand database management tools. You won't be able to easily capture it, cure it, store it, or do some statistical analysis on the data. So that kind of data is called big data in today's world. So just to give you an idea about big data, let's say there is a lot of data coming from the New York Stock Exchange. Okay, so every day they generate like 1 terabyte or 2 terabytes of data every day. How are you going to capture the data? How are you going to store the data? And how are you going to analyze the data? Okay, these sort of challenges are there now with the big data. And then let's say you have got some example from the e-commerce websites, where you have got like click streams data. Wherever you click on the application or any of the products, and wherever you move from product to product, storing that kind of data is again a very challenging thing, because a lot of users are there on the e-commerce websites, and only the interface between you and the end producer, or let's say the shopkeeper is the interface, is the website only. So how he is going to capture all that data and then analyze it to provide you the best products which you are looking for, as well as which you want to use in your daily life. So big data is huge data. Okay, big data is having a lot of volume, where we talk about the data size. The data size can go into terabytes, it can go even into petabytes and exabytes. The biggest use case I can say for the big data is storing the entire internet into the application. How can we do that? Because that's a huge, huge amount of data. So that's the volume we are looking for. That is called your big data. Velocity. Every one of us now knows that every individual is generating the data. Okay. So there's a huge volume which even everyone is generating, and the velocity, the speed at which the data is getting generated, let's say via the applications, mobile applications, via the websites, via the internet, or there can be different other ways to which the data is getting generated. And then they are having a lot of different varieties of data as well. So it can be a structured data, it can be an unstructured data in the form of audios, videos, or it can be a semi-structured data in the form of just the XML files or JSON files. And the uncertainty of the data as well. So veracity is another one of the most important characteristic of big data, where you don't have certainty when the data will arrive and when the data will not. So you want to, you know, whatever the data has got all these four characteristics is called big data. Now, how big data is stored? Okay, because traditional applications, it's difficult to store them at such fast rate. Okay, if we consider all these four characteristics, no single solution in the database is able to handle all such kind of data very easily or quickly. So how do you store big data? You might be guessing the RDBMS, but again, single solution of RDBMS is again not capable of, you know, holding such huge amount of data very easily. Well, yes, there are ways, there are databases as well. There are different types of databases that can store the data, that can process the data, but it can take a lot of time as well as processing power to do such kind of activity. So RDBMS is not the right choice for the big data, because considering the type and volume of the data, RDBMS is not the choice. As I just said, it includes a lot of costing. It includes the formatting of the data as well, which might not be in the current standards of the RDBMS. And then scalability. But RDBMS is like, most of the RDBMS today are only able to scale vertically. So you can add the storage, you can add the processing in the same set of the servers, but it's not possible to horizontally scale them. It's not possible to really scale them easily by adding more nodes or more servers. Well, you can do, but there's like a lot of there's a lot of difficulty when you do such kind of activities in the RDBMS, just the traditional RDBMS. So I'm considering here, let's say Teradata, Netezza, or Oracle, or MySQL kind of databases only. So where most of them are used for the business intelligence kind of applications. Now, what do we have now for this for resolving the such kind of issues? Okay, we have something called Hadoop. Hadoop is the savior. Hadoop is the tool today that is used to handle such kind of data. Hadoop was created actually to resolve problems of big data only. So whether the data is huge, data is small, or data has got different varieties, data is coming in with different velocities, doesn't matter for Hadoop, because the main constant, the main thing which Hadoop, with which the Hadoop was created, the principles of Hadoop after which it was created is the scalability, reliability, flexibility, and the fault tolerance. So you can store any amount of data. I mean, as such, I just told you the use case. Storing the entire internet is the use case of Hadoop. You can store the data in petabytes, exabytes. Certainly, you need those number of that amount of storage in your hard disk for that. But yes, Hadoop is a tool that can handle such huge amount of data as well. And with its known characteristics of reliability, the idea is that even your couple of nodes are down, or a couple of servers are down, or a couple of storage is down, let's say hard disks are down, you will not be losing your data, because it has got something called replication factor, where replication factor says I'm storing one copy in the data, that copy will get stored into three different places. With the help of that, even if two different places are down, even if two different servers are down, I can fetch the copy from the third place. And with its component called Hadoop Distributed File System and MapReduce, you are able to scale your file system, you're able to scale your cluster as easily as possible. And your processing power, the processing of data on the blocks of the data on which it is being stored, is also quite high. Okay. So whenever you store the data in Hadoop distributed file system, the data gets stored. There are two components in which the data gets stored. One is called name node. So name node is the metadata of the name node stores the metadata of the Hadoop cluster. So whatever the data you store in the Hadoop distributed file system, the data gets stored in the data nodes in the form of blocks. So there are two components in Hadoop distributed file system. One is called name node, another is called data node. So how it is distributed? So you have got something called multiple data nodes and you have got one name node. So you store a file, let's say test.txt, that size of the file is, let's say, 1 gigabyte. Hadoop has something called block storage. Okay. So with this block storage, it has got block size. So you store this 1 gigabyte of file in Hadoop distributed file system. This file gets converted into 4 blocks. Okay. It gets converted into 4 blocks, considering it has got a block size of 4. So these 4 blocks are being stored in different data nodes, where name node is going to store the metadata of that file. Metadata means, let's say, name of the files, or file to blocks mapping, or blocks to data node mapping. Such kind of information is being stored in the name node. And there's another huge information about the metadata. Okay. So you can store any such kind of data in the name node. So Hadoop provides that kind of a storage where you can scale your cluster. Cluster means a group of nodes consisting of data nodes and name node. So you can put any kind of data, as much amount of data as you want, into the Hadoop cluster. So Hadoop, what is that? It is an open source, scalable and reliable solution that stores and allows distributed processing of large data sets across clusters of computers using simple programming model. So first of all, it's an open source system. That is very important to understand, because this model has been created by open source community. Okay, it's not something from the enterprise. So you can easily use it with your data. You can use it in your enterprises without having any licenses, without requiring any kind of license. And you can even tweak this tool according to your reliability. So open source means the data source, the source of this particular tool is, source code of this particular tool is available online. Second thing is scalability. As I just said, you can scale your Hadoop cluster at any point of time with as many data nodes as you want. So logically, yes, there is some limit, but physically there is no limit of scaling your Hadoop distributed file system. And then third thing is reliability. As I just said, the data which gets stored in the Hadoop distributed file system is sort of replicated, it's sort of duplicated into multiple nodes, which means even if you lose one of the nodes, you won't lose your data. You will still get your data from different data nodes. So it processes the data distributedly, because your data is now distributed in multiple nodes. So Hadoop has another component which is actually its programming model, which is called MapReduce. So this MapReduce programming model allows the distributed processing of your data. So MapReduce says wherever your data is, okay, let's say the data is lying inside 5 data nodes out of 50 data nodes. So MapReduce programming model intelligently will go to those 5 data nodes, process the data, and bring back the results to the Hadoop distributed file system. So MapReduce consists of two another important components, which is called resource manager and node manager. So these two components again intelligently works on the data only on those data nodes which has got the data. So those data nodes that has got the data, the programming model of MapReduce, which is actually called YARN, it's a generic model, YARN, will work on that data on those nodes, processes the data, across the cluster of commodity computers, which are your data nodes, and then bring back the results to the Hadoop distributed file system. So if we talk about the Apache Hadoop, it has got these four components, these four modules, sorry. So first is Hadoop distributed file system. As I just said, the distributed file system approach is to store the data reliably, to store the data with some fault tolerance, and you will be able to horizontally scale this Hadoop distributed file system. That is one of the important and critical component of the Hadoop. So your storage is going to be on a reliable storage, which is your Hadoop distributed file system. You won't be losing the data unless there is a huge number of data nodes that has gone down instantly. If there are like one or two data nodes that are going down, so there won't be any losses of the data at all. And then you have got Hadoop Common, the common utilities that support the Hadoop modules. So basically the utilities that allows the Hadoop, that allows you to access the Hadoop distributed file system, or allows to access the other Hadoop modules, which basically are your internal components of Hadoop. And then you have got the Hadoop YARN. So YARN is something which I was telling you, it's the processing framework which is introduced in the newer version of Hadoop called Hadoop version 2. Full form says yet another resource negotiator. So Hadoop YARN is actually a framework for managing the resources of the cluster, as well as it helps you to schedule the jobs in the cluster with some definite amount of resources. So yet another resource negotiator is a very, very generic tool, as well as very efficient tool in processing the data, as it provides the other modules like MapReduce or Spark or Impala, even Hive, or components like Pig, Taze, lot of different tools, lot of different Hadoop ecosystems can work on YARN. Okay. So YARN today has become a standard for the Hadoop distributed files, Hadoop MapReduce part, okay, or let's say Hadoop processing. So, and then the last module is Hadoop MapReduce, a YARN-based system for parallel processing of large data sets. So with the MapReduce, basically you are able to, it's one of the module that runs on top of YARN, which helps you in processing the data lying on different data nodes. Now, out of these all four components, okay, one of the most critical component is Hadoop distributed file system, because it stores the data. Because it stores the data, it helps you to store the data in the distributed format. Distributed means the data is not lying just on the one node, it is lying on multiple nodes. Okay. Yes, it has got its own fault tolerance. So that's why you can tolerate the faults, you can tolerate the down of data nodes. For one or two data nodes, you can certainly tolerate that. But if there are multiple data nodes down instantly, then certainly there will be a loss in the data. Okay. Or even if, let's say, multiple data nodes are not an issue, even if you are able to somehow get those data nodes up and running all the time, then there is a certainly single component, which is your name node, which is storing the metadata. Now, without this name node is actually the administration node of your Hadoop cluster. So without this name node also, you won't be able to work on the cluster at all. So name node currently is the just one node in the cluster. I mean, it's not going to be the multiple name nodes, it's going to be only one name node per Hadoop cluster. So if you have a 1000 node cluster, or 10,000 node cluster, or 400 node cluster, or 4 node cluster, whatever the size of the cluster is, you can only have one name node in the Hadoop cluster that stores the metadata of the Hadoop distributed file system. Now the idea is, how can we have this up and running, this name node? Okay, so currently the name node is the single point of failure. There is no way that if the name node goes down, you will be able to get this up and running all the time. Okay, in Hadoop version 2, yes, we have got some way, that is what we are going to discuss now, which is called high availability. But let us discuss what will happen if the name node goes down. Okay, so maintaining the high availability is one of the most critical tasks of a Hadoop administrator. Okay, now in the data nodes, if you talk about the data nodes, they are already scalable. You can horizontally scale them, you can add as many data nodes as you want in the Hadoop cluster. But name node, this actually manages the blocks. It manages the metadata of your data lying inside the HDFS. So name node, it's not possible to horizontally scale it. There is no provision in the Hadoop as of now where you can horizontally scale the name node. You have something called name node federation, in which you can actually have multiple name nodes in the Hadoop cluster, but again they are also going to be one in their own, one as of their own, like one name node is responsible for storing the data of one particular domain. So what I'm trying to say is, you can scale your name node, you can federate your name node, which is called name node federation. You can have multiple name nodes, but one name node again in that particular module will be going to handle one particular domain's data, which means if that particular name node goes down, again you will not be able to access that domain's data at all. So name node is the single point of failure. Even if you are having multiple name nodes, even if you are having name node federation, or let's say there are multiple, you know, things in the name node. So Hadoop says that either bring the Linux cases like RAID 1 or RAID 0 to bring the high availability on the Linux level, that also you can do, or you can do one more thing, you can bring the name node high availability. Okay, so name node high availability means in the cluster have one active name node and have a standby name node. If both the active and standby are down, certainly you will lose the data, certainly you won't be able to do anything into the cluster. Or if one of the active goes down, then standby will become active and you will be at least able to access your cluster. So your whole cluster will not go down. I mean, take any component of Hadoop ecosystem, Pig, Hive, HBase, Impala, Yarn, Scoop, Flume, Hue, Solar, Uzi, whatever it is, they're all dependent upon the name node. If your name node is not there, you won't be able to access the cluster. So by default, Hadoop comes with something called secondary name node. So what is the secondary name node? Secondary name node is the standby name node for Hadoop that helps you in bringing back the, that helps you in recovering the name node's metadata, but allows you to have some downtime. But it actually provides you some downtime. Without some downtime, you cannot recover your name node. Second thing is, because name node is a single point of failure, again the secondary name node does not have that capability to provide you a hot standby. Okay, I mean, you need to have that downtime, you need to have some manual intervention so that you can bring the primary name node up. So what secondary name node does is, it connects to the name node every hour, back up the primary name node's metadata, and then bring back that metadata into the cluster. So it's sort of doing the backup of name node's metadata. It's sort of doing the housekeeping operations. And you can certainly build the primary name node once again by saving that metadata from the secondary name node. But the challenge here with the secondary name node is, let's say this 1 hour, which is actually a configurable parameter in secondary name node, let's say you decrease it to 10 minutes or 5 minutes. So the challenge here is, if you decrease it to 5 or 10 minutes, basically what you are trying to do is, you are asking the secondary name node to fetch the name node metadata, which can go into multiple gigabytes every 5 or 10 minutes. So you are moving some 10 gigabytes or 15 gigabytes of metadata every 5 or 10 minutes on the network, which can actually have a lot of performance impact. Second thing is, let's say if you keep this backup checkpoint period every hour, so within, let's say, after 55 or 56 minutes your primary name node goes down, then secondary name node will also be not able to bring back that 55-56 minutes metadata, because it did not connect to the name node in that particular period. So secondary name node again is not a reliable name node. Secondary name node is not a name node that helps you in bringing the metadata failed from the failed primary name node. Okay, so you will lose some set of metadata. You will lose some point of data in from the secondary name node as well. So what Hadoop comes with, Hadoop says that okay, let's not talk about the secondary name node. Let's remove that as well and bring my newer feature, which is called high availability. So high availability is a way through which you can you can have a standby name node, you can have an active name node and standby name node. You can if your active name node goes down, standby can become active and give you the operations, give you the operational capability through which you can access your data as well as process the data. But this high availability is quite complex architecture. If you see, even lot of components are being displayed here. So you can see an active name node and a standby name node. You can see multiple data nodes here. You can see the shared edit logs directly, where you can have multiple, you can see multiple journal nodes here. So these journal nodes are not doing much, but they're actually backing up the primary name node's metadata. So the idea is, in a very simple term, if I say this active name node, whatever metadata it is taking, this metadata is being backed up by these journal nodes. So all the metadata which is being backed up by journal nodes are being read by this standby name node. So in this way, both the active and standby are getting in sync, because one is writing and another is reading. And to trigger the failover, we have something called active zookeeper failover controller and standby zookeeper failover controller. So this active and standby is actually monitoring the liveness and health of these name nodes. So if the active goes down, then standby name node will become active, and this activeness is being provided by this zookeeper failover controller. So how this zookeeper failover controller provide the availability will trigger this failover from standby to active. Zookeeper failover controller stores some data in the zookeeper cluster, where it actually keeps a lock. It keeps a active standby lock that it triggers that active standby lock. It this active zookeeper failover controller releases the lock, and the standby zookeeper failover controller takes that lock and make the standby name node as an active name. So in this scenario, this zookeeper service can be highly available. It is one of the most important component of Hadoop ecosystem. Without this zookeeper service, lot of Hadoop ecosystem components as well as Hadoop high availability cannot run. And for this, these journal nodes are also highly available. You can have 3, 5, 7, 9 journal nodes, whatever number of zookeeper journal nodes you want. Now, one of the most important concept in this, another important concept here is called fencing. So before this zookeeper failover controller from the standby triggers the failover, standby name node ensures that active name node is not running at all. So it tries to ensure that active name node was not giving the signals because it was slow. So it tries to make sure that two name nodes will not be active at some point of at that point of time. So what zookeeper failover controller does, it asks the standby name node to do the fencing mechanism. What is fencing? Standby name node SSH into the active name node, kill the active name node process if it is running. Standby name node SSH into the active name node if it is running, kill the active name node process, and then becomes active. This way, zookeeper failover controller ensures that both the name node are not active at same point of time. So this whole scenario requires different components, but can be easily built on the laptop. It can be easily, you can easily build this kind of architecture with a 3-node cluster, which I am going to show you now, where in this case, what I have done is I have taken the help of 3 nodes. So I hope everyone can see this. So here I'm running a for loop, a small for loop from 1 to 3, where I'm doing an SSH into 3 nodes. This is my host name. It is showing three host names here: name node 1, name node 2, and data node 1. So let's say I have got two name nodes, active and standby, and I have got just one name node. And these are my, this is my JPS command Java processes. Are there any Java processes currently running or not? And I'm just giving one single line. Okay. So guys, if you are not able to see my screen right now, I would request everyone, I would request that guy to please rejoin. Okay. It's good if you can rejoin, because I am not really sure why you are not able to see. And that certainly will be something from the Citrix. Okay. So I'm running right now these three nodes. So what I want to do is, I want to first run the zookeeper. So I've got some steps here written by me, where to run the zookeeper, first I'm doing some creating an ID for the zookeeper servers, and then I want to start three journal nodes. So as I just shown you in the diagram, so three journal nodes is what I'm going to start with first. As you can see, it is starting the journal node with a process, and using the for loop, I will be able to show you what is that process name. So this, the process name is nothing but the journal node on. You can see three journal nodes are currently running now into my cluster. Okay. So these are the three journal nodes right now. Once it is running fine, I will format my name node. I will start the name nodes. So first of all, I will start one name node, and then I will start the second name node. But currently, if you see, I've got two name nodes in my cluster architecture, and I have got three journal nodes here. So two name nodes on two different nodes here, and three journal nodes on three different nodes. The next step is to start the zookeeper. So if you see, I've got another process, a Java process, which is called quorum peer main. This is going to help me to, this is going to help the zookeeper failover controller to maintain that particular storage, which is called active standby elector log. We can even see that particular storage. It's not something hypothetical. So once the zookeeper is, once the data node is started, we are formatting the zookeeper failover controller. So you can see now, I'm going to start the zookeeper failover controller with the Hadoop daemon.sh start zkfc command. Now this process, I understand that this process might be a bit faster for you guys. Okay, you're not able to get that much from this. But yes, we do cover very much in detail in our sessions. I explain how this whole architecture can be created on the cluster. But here you can see whatever I've just shown you on this slide, okay, as a in the slide in the presentation, you can see two name nodes here. We have got two name nodes, two zookeeper failover controllers, active and standby, three journal nodes, three journal node daemons, and one data node. So I've not kept multiple data nodes. I've just kept one data node here. Okay. So with this, now if I run the command on the active name node, let's say, first of all, it should say active, as you can see. And for name node 2, it should say standby. So I've got an active name node and standby name node right now. Okay, so the idea is, if I want to test this high availability, so can somebody tell me how should I test this high availability right now? Absolutely. So I should kill the active name node. If I kill the active name node, the standby should automatically become active. So if I kill the process of active name node with this command, this is the hard stop, hard kill of process of the active name node. And now if I do a get service state of name node 2, then this should be active now, as you can see, while name node 1 should not be reachable because name node 1 is currently down. So it should say failed on connection exception. Okay, so with this way, we can always bring the high availability in the Hadoop cluster, and we can say that in the version 2 of Hadoop 2, we can have this high availability. You can configure it at any point of time, so that even if your active name node is down, the standby will automatically become active and will provide the developers the usage of the Hadoop distributed file system. Now, along with this, we have YARN as well, which is again the single point of failure for Hadoop. Okay, YARN says that this resource manager, which is going to run the, which is going to process these jobs, this is also a single point of failure. If active goes down, then how the jobs are going to process on resource manager? So YARN also in Hadoop version 2 is currently the has become highly available. You can have a active resource manager and a standby resource manager, where they can, again, the Zookeeper failover controller is going to provide the detection of the failures of the resource manager as well, and make the resource manager, active resource manager, if the active resource manager goes down, then standby resource manager, it will make the standby resource manager as an active resource manager. So the idea is that the jobs, because they are not going to store any data, so again, they are not that highly critical in the cluster, but yes, in the production, certainly you don't want to lose your resource manager at all, because they will, the jobs will not run at all if the resource manager is down. So what Hadoop version 2, what YARN says, that if the active resource manager is down, then you can always bring back the active resource manager. Your jobs will keep on running. Your jobs may continue to run. What you need to do is you need to make this resource manager also highly available. Okay, so this resource manager is going to store the state of the job in which the job was running, and this state is going to be stored inside the Zookeeper. So it will take the state of the job, will put the state in the Zookeeper, so that from whatever state the job has just got killed, or let's say the job has just got stopped because of the resource manager active to standby switch, the job will continue from that particular state only and will accomplish the end of that particular job. So how it can be done? Again, the configurations are, I've already done the configurations. So in the Hadoop etc YARN site, I've given a lot of configurations for the resource manager as well, like for the name node. As you can see in the YARN site.xml, some configurations are being done for the resource manager. So what you need to do is you need to start the YARN, and you will see here as well that this YARN is also highly available. So if I start the resource manager on the name node 1 and on the name node 2, so for running the YARN, actually you need the node manager, basically where the data is going to be processed. And we have started the node manager as well. So if I show you my complete cluster now with the file system as well as processing, you can see we have got something called resource manager active one. So that can be seen by the help of a command. rmadmin-get-service-state-resource-manager-1, you can see an active resource manager. And similarly, you can see a standby resource manager on the name node 2. Now there are various ways of accomplishing this architecture, which we discussed in the in our sessions, Hadoop administration sessions. But here I'm just trying to show you that how this cluster is being created here. So two name nodes where we have got two resource manager as well, and then we have got one node manager which is going to process the data. So you run your job, you complete the job, and then you will find out that you can always you know, complete this job without any intervention. And even if the resource manager, the active resource manager goes down, your other resource manager will automatically become active. So simple test can easily be done by just killing the resource manager here. You will see the other resource manager will automatically become active. So if I kill this process of resource manager and try to check the service state of resource manager 2 first, you will see an active resource manager here. So it says this standby, and the currently resource manager is not there. So you can go to the name node 2 once. Say the active resource manager. Right, so you can see now it has failed over to active name node, active resource manager. So that is the advantage of this resource manager as well. I think it took some time to fail over. So that is the advantage of resource manager as well in the Hadoop cluster version 2, where you can have multiple name nodes, multiple resource manager. So once this architecture is being created, admin will can take some breathing space, where he can always have two name nodes, where the active goes down, standby will become active, jobs will not get hampered, and you will have some time to bring the failed name node or failed resource manager up by having some manual interventions. Okay, so I hope you got this a bit clarity about these things, guys. So we have done quite a bit of hands-on to achieve this HDFS and YARN high availability. Now this was, I understand, a bit fast, but yes, I can explain this in more detail in the sessions. So question here, that what happens if one of the data node goes down? As I said, even if one of the data node goes down, there is no problem, because Hadoop distributed file system has already got some fault tolerance, where the data which is being stored in the Hadoop distributed file system is going to be stored on multiple data nodes. So if one of the data node goes down, the data can be fetched from the other data nodes in the cluster. So that is the advantage. Okay. So name node is one, but there are multiple data nodes. Okay. Now, security is another important aspect of this Hadoop distributed file system, where if I try to access the HDFS, okay, you can see currently there's nothing inside my HDFS. But what I want is, I want to give two different projects, two different access to the directory. So let's say I have got something for slash input. Bit slow here because of a lot of processes running. And then I have got the output directory. So just two directories with different names I have created, nothing much. Now what I want is, I want to give the access to two different projects on the input directory, and two different projects on the output directory as well. Okay. So Hadoop has got something called access control list. So this access control list is having very much the same concept as you have in the Linux. In the Linux also, you have got something called access control list, where if you want to give the access to multiple projects on the same directory, how you will do. So you will use something called access control list. So if I run the command getfacl, getfacl means get access control list on the slash input directory. How will I do that? I will use getfacl and slash input. It will show me what are the current permissions on this directory? The current permissions on this directory is, the owner is Hadoop user and the group is supergroup right now. But what if I want to change this users and group? I want to give additional permissions to this directory. So I will say set fsl hyphen m hyphen r. The user, let's say, is developer one. I want to give only read and write permissions. And group, I would say financial group. I want to give only read and write permissions to this financial group. And then on the input directory. So once I give this permissions to this slash input directory, slash input directory, it will get those additional permissions. And besides the Hadoop user, okay, so it says dfs.namenode.acl.enabled to false. So it has been rejected right now. That's fine. Okay, so I think this property is only enabled only on one name node. It should be enabled on both the name node. As you can see, it's not actually disabled here, but it's enabled only on one name node. So we'll go to the other name node as well. You can see easily we can perform this operation here because we have got multiple name nodes. So once I switch is back to the name node. You can see now the permissions have been set successfully to the name node. And now if I do a get fsl on the slash input directory, I can see the permissions will be given to the developer one user and the group financial. So I can provide the individual users and individual groups permissions to this directory. This is how you will secure your data. This is how you will provide the access to the cluster. Okay, I can do the same thing for the marketing group as well. So these groups or users are being stored in the LDAP. Okay, so the way you will do is, like, you will store all the users and groups in the LDAP. You will provide the access to your Linux nodes via this LDAP, and then you will provide the permissions via these ACLs to the Hadoop distributed file system. So thereby you're controlling your Hadoop distributed file system from here. So I have given additional permissions now to the marketing group also. Let's say read, write, execute. So multiple users are being given the permissions now onto this directory. So they can store the data and then they can put the data into their output directories accordingly. Certainly we need to provide the permissions on the output directory as well. Otherwise they won't be able to access the output directory. So Hadoop is the secure data warehouse solutions. Certainly you are able to store a lot of data. Okay. But now the question is what to do with big data. So Hadoop is the perfect data warehouse. You have got free text, you have got images, videos, transactions, logs, you have got sensors data, whatever it is, you can store it into the Hadoop distributed file system. All these files are going to be stored in the file format only. There is no other format in which you can store the files in the HDFS. Well, customizations are there. Certainly you want to compress the data, you want to store in some text format, you want to store in input format, some different formats are there. But yes, by default, they're all there in the file input format only. Whatever the format of the file is, you can store it into the Hadoop distributed file system. Now, with the help of this, when you have got stored all this data in the HDFS, you have got different tools. Like Hadoop provides tool called Hype query language, Impala query language. You have got something called Spark on Hive. You have got Hue. You have got Scoop, Flume. All these tools are there that helps you to import, export the data, that helps you to analyze the data lying inside the HDFS, that helps you to process the data inside the HDFS. And then you can store it into your final destination area from where through which you can use the tools like Tableau, Pentaho, Cognos, ClickView kind of tools, where they will take the data form and then put it into the nice reports format. They will generate the reports and give you the and help you to generate the reports and provide the interface through which you can analyze the data. You can see what is going on inside the data. So Hadoop Distributed File System is actually the perfect data warehouse today, where most of the projects where which we have got like lot of data. I mean, taking an example of simple tweets or Facebook data or logs data. I mean, any ad hoc data analysis if you want to do, that can easily be done with the help of Hadoop kind of tool. So I think, guys, this is what we have from our webinar today. If you have any questions you want to ask about our webinar or let's say about our course, you can ask from me. To view the course, if you want to, you can go to a website called edureka.co, and there you will get the on the interface itself, you get the course like called Hadoop Administration, which is having like online classes of 24 hours, assignment of 30 hours, project of 20 hours, and lifetime access to the learning management system. You can see various batches which are on upcoming batches of the Hadoop admin training. You can see the curriculum of the batch. You can see a course. You can see the frequently asked questions about the software, hardware requirements, how you're going to access the LMS and all. You can see the certification also, which is being provided by the Edureka, how you can achieve that certification. You can see a sample class recording as well, which we provide so that you can check out that recording and see how this course is actually being taught. You can see the upcoming batches. You can see the blogs of this particular course. And the most important thing is you will get an offer as well. So get HBase or Perl or Linux self-paced course absolutely free, and you can enroll for now. So the important point which I want to say is that prerequisite of this course is actually to have the understanding of Linux. If you want to, if you enroll for this course and you don't have any understanding of Linux, then you can easily take this Linux self-paced course, understand about Linux, and then go into the deep dive of Hadoop administration. So I think, guys, that's all from my side today. If you have any specific questions you want to ask, please go ahead. Go ahead, please, Manjusha. You can certainly install it on VirtualBox as well. I'm using VMware Workstation. You can use it on VirtualBox also. Okay, guys. So I think you like this webinar. Okay. Hope I have answered all of your questions. Thanks a lot for joining in. See you in the next webinars of Hadoop Administration.